Molly, your films are always, as I was saying, known for their ability to get people to say things that you think, gosh, I can't quite believe that they said that. And it's not that they're making a revelation about some smutty bit of their past, but they're talking about their feelings, a real yeah. vulnerability. How did you get to that? How did it start?
It's sort of, that specific style came about almost, not by accident, but because I was making a film about a friend of mine's father, and he was going through a process of change, and I'd actually been very traditionally taught to make the kind of films where you stick people on a sofa, shine a light at them and say, talk, and basically they dry up. And so I was at film school learning how to shoot much more observationally. And the combination of me struggling to try and shoot and this technique whereby you follow people, and the fact that I was sort of responsible for this man who I was filming, because basically he'd come back from Africa after a lifetime of being looked after by people and was suddenly living in a car park in Wiltshire and had to look after himself. But I was there, so I was his staff, as was my sound recordist. And it was a learning process, but what came out of it I thought was deeply satisfying, which was a way of telling stories about people or institutions whereby you don't just go for the facts, you don't go for the shock, horror, revelation, you're not being ostensibly journalistic. What you're trying to capture is something of the essence of that person. And it means it can be more intrusive. I mean, you have to be much more careful about it because you're making films about people much more than you are about issues, although the issues drive it. So actually, just to sort of, I quite wanted to show a clip quite early on, just in case people hadn't seen any of this stuff, which is, it's a clip of this man I made. It was started as a student film, but ended up in the BBC and showed 4 or 5 times. And in fact, when he died, they gave an obituary screening. That's better, thank you. Because there was something about him that just captured people, and he has absolutely no idea how to look after himself. And I followed him back from Africa to England, where I realized my presence is affecting reality. Because basically, when you film people very closely and you become part of it, you have to be very careful you don't start actually changing what would happen. And since we were looking after him, we were. So one day I said, you have to go shopping and you've got to learn how to cook, because when Sarah and I finish filming, you're gonna have to do this on your own. Unless your sons come and look after you, or a nurse or somebody. And what resulted was this cooking sequence, which is a couple of minutes long, but I'd love to just show it. So this is Colonel Hook.
I love to look.
Unusual fruit as well.
Such a variety of cheese, of course, you know, we're spoiled for choice.
Particularly in the fresh food line, I like the meat because they cater for different sorts of people.
It's such good value.
Better value for money. No two ways about it.
Here we are, ravioli. Now, we put in this bloody machine. It opens it in a flash. We'll see. It doesn't really work. You do it, darling. I can't manage this thing.
Well, you've got to learn to open a can. Sarah, go and go.
Basically, he doesn't open it, and he says, sweetie, you fucking well do it. And then the sound recordist has to go in and open his can. And it's a sort of, it's a borderline scene, because it's, I thought it was hilarious at the time. I mean, the camera's shaking because I'm laughing so much, but it's also very sad, and it was a way of trying to show a number of things, which is also to show that, you know, what is he actually going to do? He sits down at the end of the scene, says, I can't manage that at all. And with him, what you hope by making these films that are really about microcosms, by individuals or small situations, but you're trying to talk about a much bigger picture. It was about old age, it was about change, it was about the end of empire, it was about Not that we're supposed to lament that, but for him personally, it was too massive a change. And so you have a scene like that that's ostensibly a bit frivolous and silly and slapstick that you hope is really about much deeper things.
One life at a time, as we were hearing.
Yeah, absolutely.
Very much so. But he's a single individual there, and your films quite quickly in your career went on to really big institutions. I mean, the Tube, but I mean, probably the biggest and the most difficult, which seems to me from the outside, was taking on the army in the Company of Men in Northern Ireland at the start of the 90s, when they were in active service. That must have been...
I'm making a very silly film about an officer in his police station in Rosslea wishing he was in a cocktail dress. It was quite a personal series of films. It was a 3 1-hours about the Welsh Guards in Northern Ireland. And one of the things about making films like this, or what for everybody who's trying to make films, is access is such a key issue. Why people say yes, why institutions say yes, who's going to get what out of it. And the army as a whole, that was a hard push to get the access, but it was the individuals that made it so complicated, getting people to spend that much time with you, to give you that much.
So how do you do it? How did you do it in that case?
I think one thing is by making it very clear by your behaviour and the questions you ask, what it is that you're after, which sometimes means that you're journalistically quite irresponsible because there may be things going on that I am not going to be interested in. I'm deliberately not going to show an interest in it because the organisation are going to stop trusting me. So if you show too much interest in running around after soldiers getting pissed in Port Rush, then the sergeant's mess are going to sniff that you're up to something and they're going to close off access in other areas. And I've always made quite long films. If it's an individual, it goes on for quite a long time, but institutions even longer. And you have to have a very long relationship with the institution.
How long were you, so to speak, in bed with the army?
For about a year in a barracks in Northern Ireland, commuting, and then another 6 or 7 months in the edit. I mean, they're long films. I'm not there the whole time. It's just that you have to... I never tell people to do things, so I'm trying to fit around their... what they're doing and when and with whom and what mood they're in. And if somebody doesn't want you to film them, it's going to show so badly in the film you shoot. You've got to somehow put yourself in a position where you're useful in their lives or in their situation. Crispin Black in the army let me film because he was bored out of his mind. He was in a police station in Fermanagh with 100 blokes guarding a police station, and he was actually a very good natural actor. So, you know, he quite fancied a bit of showing off, and that's what he did. He's wonderful on camera. And Hilary Hook was lonely. That's why he did it. People always have a reason why they do it. And then you have this very brief courtship, always off camera. I mean, sorry, on camera. I always have my camera with me. But you have to get to know each other on film, I think.
And how do you build up the trust? I mean, I know you've put down a certain level of boundaries. Do you like saying, I won't follow them when they're getting pissed and picking up girls downtown? But do you make that actually verbally clear, or is it just an instinct that is understood by all?
No, I probably make it clear to them by being part of them. I mean, I'd love to show that clip from the underground. You know, if there's no time.
Your DVD's packed up.
Oh, they've all packed up? Oh, we have no clips. Okay.
Camera woman's left now.
No, just organisations. Sorry. I got into London Underground and filmed in a tube station that was so dilapidated. It was so horrific. But the film at no point says, actually, this is the oldest station on the oldest line. It's the deepest. It's a Victorian infrastructure. What it was a portrait of these melancholic, distressed people, but also hilarious people that worked in the tube. And I think that's how you can get away with it, which is that a lot of people, when they... go into organisations, really probably are after. Not the dirt, but you want to reveal something. People are people want to be investigative. I'm not after that at all. I mean, if it comes in naturally, discovering that the fluffers, that the tube tunnels were still hand-swept with dustpans and brushes by old ladies, was a revelation, and actually it coloured the rest of the film, which was full of this wonderful outpouring of people, but that was such an extraordinary bit of information. That focuses people's mind on it, and you make a difference, have a different sort of impact.
But certainly in The Angel, it's as though you're very much getting at the truth about people rather than the truth about the institution. I mean, as you say about Mr. Perkins in his ticket office, probably no one has talked to Mr. Perkins in, I don't know, years, possibly.
Well, I like to make films about people or people in situations that you wouldn't, that you would walk past, that you would ignore, that you wouldn't normally stop and be interested in. I mean, apart from Geri Halliwell, that was an exception.
And Tony Blair.
And Tony Blair, that was, well, that was prostitution because I was asked to, and I was confused as to what I was doing. But actually, it was very interesting because I, well, for me it was, because it was Richard Eyre from the National Theatre thought that Tony Blair, when nobody knew who Tony Blair was and he'd taken over the Labour Party, Richard Eyre was asked to make a portrait film of him. And he said, no, he shouldn't. You know, he's such a nice guy. Sorry, Gerald. That he's got to be, you know, get someone like Molly Dineen to do a portrait film of him. I don't want to direct him. But the problem is nobody had told that to Alistair Campbell. So Alistair Campbell was constantly turning up with makeup artists and Tony be covered in orange makeup and I'd be supposed to ask him questions. And I'd say, I just have to spend time with him. I've just got to be around his house. We've just got to see, you know, what, how he, just how to make him an attractive and plausible character. So 3 months later, and after a really big struggle with Cherie, who didn't want any of it out, we got this little vignette, a moment in his kitchen, which was just a moment where I could get him finally get rid of the paraphernalia, the people that were making him talk badly to camera. And actually, he's quite an attractive personality in that film, but I shouldn't have done it. If you make documentaries, no, of course I shouldn't have done it because, because you get branded afterwards. And anyway, he thought I was a compulsive Tory because all my films seem to be about the collapse of old Britain because my films are all about change.
Yes, that's what I was actually going to...
So I'm not keen on politicians or new politicians at all. It was, honestly, it was an aberration, but it was very short.
However, all politicians do say that, you know, we're ready for change, but you really do look for an institution that is changing. Why is that?
Because I get very distressed by change, very interested by change. If you live in England, particularly London at the moment, the change is aggressive. I mean, they're literally digging the ground up under your feet as you stand there. And I, looking back, I suppose, as I have done for this, these films coming out, I do realise it's pretty much the same film for about 28 years. It is either me lamenting change or it's just prior to change. The Underground is a situation of such total dilapidation, but it was about to be. It was before it got its facelift. The House of Lords was just before the hereditary peers all had to reapply for their peerages, so to speak, or their seat in the Lords. I think that change is a time that throws up questions, distress, it puts people on the edge. It's like moving house. Suddenly, you're questioning a lot of things. You're naturally focused. And because I don't direct people, I need to be filming people who are in a state, they're sort of à point already. Mm. You know, they're already
they're
doing.
Open.
Yes, or they're going through a process. Yeah. Geri Halliwell, okay, that was an unusual one for me, but she, as because I always do male institutions, she had left the Spice Girls and gone into hiding, but with a camera. So she had met me because I'd been to see the Spice Girls, but Posh Spice wasn't sure about my film about the zoo, so I didn't do that, and I think it's just as well. In fact, it's because she watched it fast forward and thought I'd made a film about a restaurant where they fed people dead mice. It was surreal. But filming, filming the way I film with famous people is actually very difficult.
But before we get to the end of our 15 minutes, I told you it would go by so fast, I'd really like to talk about The Lie of the Land, because so quite a lot of things happened to you in The Lie of the Land, didn't they? I mean, one of them being that you did...
Yes, normally if I discover...
You did sort of go to something.
Well, I think what happened is that normally when I discover, as you do in every single situation, something going on that possibly... with your journalistic hat on, you should be talking about, whether it's to do with selling off the real estate of London Zoo or whatever it is. And I was making this soppy series about how everyone felt about redundancy and the collapse of hierarchies and institutions. When it came to the farming hunting film, I was so shocked, so distressed by what I saw, that actually I put aside the kind of film I would have normally made, which would have been a portrait of two old bachelor farmers. And I did make quite an aggressive didactic film that's full of nasty bits and the stuff that I wouldn't normally put in. And I did it very deliberately because I wanted to shock people. I wanted them to feel what I had felt. Normally you put that aside. I never make films about process where we all talk about how you get access. But I want people to feel they're absolutely involved and with those people. Because also if you like people and you're involved with them, you might shoulder or stomach more of their remarks or attitudes or ways of life that otherwise you might be repelled by. So it is a way of questioning people's prejudices and stereotypes. But Lie of the Land, I couldn't do that because I suppose it was my rather naive discovery that masses of healthy animals are just shot in this country because we commit to importing food, which is where you and I have done many sessions about it. And because 700 hours of parliamentary time had been spent discussing hunting, I knew that because I'd been sitting in the Lords as the bill to'd and fro'd, and 6 hours spent discussing the Iraq war. I thought, actually, if we really do think we're a nation of animal lovers, let's just have a little look at the food industry, which is something I discovered just following a truck round, which is just the slaughtering of these animals. And they're fed to hounds as opposed to us. And it was a real departure from my normal sort of film because I felt so angry about it.
And it got a fantastic amount of attention. It is, for anyone who hasn't seen it, it's a really, really important and vital film, which has got a pretty brutal few scenes in it when the calves are shot and then skinned in a truly horrible way.
Also, I'm terribly sorry that people couldn't see any clips. Because I'm so bad at talking to the public, as you can see, because I have to be interviewed. My whole life has become questions and answers. I can no longer talk.
Well, it's always a pleasure to talk to you. But now we have reached our 15 minutes, and I apologise about the film situation, but we did get to see... We were only going to show one clip in the end, and we got to see half of it, so it's been a bit of a loss. But, Molly, thank you so much.
It's pleasure.
Been fantastic. And please buy Molly's DVD, as you did...